You talked about the need to scale back after the new setup now, or the 4 billion pesos daily. President Marcos Jr. also, he actually expressed caution that with the fact that I think we're 63% GDP ratio, debt to GDP ratio. So are we at an alarming phase today?
Well, hindi naman siguro. But it is the towards the upper end already. You're talking maybe when you hit 70%, then you really we don't really want to reach that, I think. Because previous to the pandemic, bago nag-pandemic, Karen, we were at 39% deficit to or debt to GDP ratio, no? So now we're at 63, as you correctly stated. So I think they're going to scale that back to, I think, maybe 50+% by the time the president's term ends. So I think we have this thing called the medium-term fiscal framework,
yeah,
basically, which is a guide for how we're supposed to perform year on year. So we see if we're falling behind or if we're ahead of schedule. So far we're on schedule because in the first year, no? It's to scale back to around 66, between 60 to 61%. So I think with that plan in 2024 to borrow less, the debt to GDP ratio will also go down.
Okay, so now specifics on the budget. In your column, you wrote that you're seeing actually that this budget is ensuring food security. I wanted to ask you, Senator, what made you say that, considering that the agricultural sector in this budget, correct me if I'm wrong, sir, no, the budget of the DA is only at 181 billion. You have the flood control budget at 255 billion in the 2024 budget. So, nakakagulat nga for some that you have flood control at 255. It's bigger than railways, bigger than irrigation, bigger even than the Defense Department. DA is still at 181.
Yeah, that's correct, Karen. But those things should be viewed separately. I mean, it's an important point that you make, and the flood control has grown tremendously. But that's a separate, I think that should be tackled separately from food security, because the budget of the DA has also grown over time. It used to be just around 150 billion, I think.
There was a phase I was interviewing you, it was at 90.
Okay, good.
Right, right.
Yeah, so
Yeah,
now it's
I remember.
so it's practically double now, no? So but unfortunately, yeah, the budget for flood control, well, not unfortunately, but because the needs have also, as we've seen, the flooding in Central Luzon, particularly in the last few weeks, Karen, which has left many people living in relief centers, no? So hindi sila makabalik sa kanilang bahay. It shows that the flooding problem has gotten worse because extreme climate is also upon us. The age of extreme climate is also upon us, Karen, no? But back to food security. I think the president really, it's really a priority of the president. It was one of his campaign promises. That's why the budget is submitted by the DBM, shows much increased allocation over previous years. And there's a lot allocated to the basic crops, to rice, to corn, among others, no? So I think that's what we refer to when we look for food security. And of course, it's a food insecure time because of the war in Ukraine has caused prices to rise. It even led India to have a no,
No
they're not
export.
selling rice anymore because they're prioritizing their citizens, not their domestic market. So in that sense, it is a food security budget because we need to secure our supplies. But that's a matter also for our external or foreign policy. But definitely, I think the president is doing his best to address these problems.
I'm curious. I mean, I know you're Finance Committee Chair, but when it comes to agriculture, I wanted to know your personal stand as a senator. For example, two things being talked about now. There are sectors that want to remove the NFA altogether because the NFA is still importing instead of buying from local farmers. And the NFA was formed, panahon pa to ng tatay mo, Senator Angara. What should we do with the NFA?
Well, the NFA's been there since the 1950s. It used to be the Rice and Corn Administration, transformed to the NFA. But its powers have been scaled back dramatically with the law, the rice tarification law, Karen. In fact, now importation, because the allegation was, or the in the it seemed that there was a mafia which developed of the traders, so they would just play with the price of rice, no? So and only a select few were allowed to import with the quotas. So what the rice tarification law did is that it allowed anyone to import, which is what is happening now. So it's not just the government that's trying, and the NFA that's trying to secure supplies of rice, but it's also the private sector which is entering into private contracts and deals for rice. So this prevents a wide scale corruption, and prevents because it doesn't put the decision to import in the hands of a few.
Karen, do we still need the NFA?
I think you need it in certain times to stabilize and to also, because it's already there and they already have their warehouses, Karen. So they need also to maintain a few months or a few days stocks of rice in times where there is a lean supply, then the government can step in. But yes, it's one of its roles should be to purchase some of the local supply also. That would be favorable. And that's along the lines of what we've been advocating, yung Tatak Pinoy, where we really prioritize our domestic and local producers rather than just import, because it's not really a sustainable long-term policy to import so much, Karen.
Okay. All right. Now, with the 2024 budget, this is almost 10% higher than this year's budget. Looking at it, just in an overview, where did the 10% go, Senator?
Sorry, say that again.
So the 2024 budget is almost 10% higher than this year's budget. In an overview, where did the 10% go?
Well, I think if you look at all the budgets, the top 10, they're higher, I think. So you're talking about, education is always the biggest. So,
pero
in
Senator,
2023, it was around 890. Now it's 925, practically. I'm rounding off, Karen. Uh-huh. No? The DPWH is 894. Well, it's lower. It's 822. But I expect that to go higher because as it passes through Congress, usually they put in infrastructure projects for their district. So that historically goes higher from the National Expenditure Program, which is the budget submitted by the DBM to Congress. As soon as it passes the legislative mill, that budget historically goes up. DOH will also go up because also legislators insert funds in hospitals to, it's what they call the MAIP program, or the Medical Assistance to Indigent Indigent that is usually increased in the last few years now. So those ones. The DILG budget is also up. The National Defense is also up by 30 billion, Karen. The DOTR budget is also increased, as well as agriculture, which we've discussed. So those are some of the departments which have gone up, which make up collectively the 10% you're asking about.
So I know that the deliberations are still ongoing. I wanted to ask you this. You mentioned the Department of Health. Congressman Ralph Recto pointed out in the lower house that there's a drop of 10 billion in the DOH budget. And he says it's the four specialty health facilities, lung center, kidney center, heart center, children's medical center. The budget for those four hospitals, he says, dropped by close to a billion. Are you seeing that already?
That's because of non-recurring expenses, meaning may building siguro na kinonstruct. So that building is no longer needed for this year. But as I said, Karen, usually those budgets will go up by the time when you see in December, when we've gone through the budget process in the House, when we've gone through the budget process in the Senate, you will see the amount increased by, I would suspect, a 10 to 20 billion is my guess, Karen.
So, Senator, this particular statement, I wanted your reaction on this. Congressman Recto said the budget for social services in the 2024 NEP has been taken over by spending for big payroll overhead expenses in maintaining a large bureaucracy, and he says rising debt service. So compared to 2023, tanong ko una, Senator, is the 11% debt servicing higher? What's our 2023 debt service?
I don't have the figure, Karma. It's around the same. If ever it's increased, it's not dramatic. It's around maybe 10%. So you're talking about maybe a 1-2% increase, which is not which is not a huge increase. But maybe I think former Senator Rekt is correct as to the personal services have increased because you have to hire more nurses, you have to hire more teachers, you have to hire more policemen. You also have to implement some of the government's programs, for instance, like the free college education or the UAPTEA law, universal access to quality tertiary education. The CHED is already complaining that its personnel is inadequate because the CHED was originally conceived as a regulatory agency and not really one that was conceptualized to give free college. And later on, we passed the free college education. So now they have to hire so many people just to distribute education vouchers, etc. And it's the same for PhilHealth, for instance. The DOH plantilla, under the local government code, a lot of the personnel of the DOH was spun off to the local governments. Mm-hmm. But now then we passed the universal healthcare. So now you need more frontliners to deliver healthcare. So it actually will, Senator Rekt is correct, but it will actually still have to increase probably to adequately deliver these very ambitious social programs over time, education, free college education, universal healthcare, because you don't have the personnel at the front lines to deliver it unless you renationalize maybe some of the hospitals or you work together with the local governments, no?
No. So as Finance Committee Chair, with the President's, it's actually in his agenda to right size. That's one. And yet Senate President Mick Zubiri said the Department of Water, he wants that passed by the end of the year. I think kasama ba Department of Virology? Priority nyo ba yan sa Senado?
Yes, the Virology Institute, the Center for Disease Control. I think these are priorities.
Tatlo ba? So you'll also have to fund that. Kasama na ba to, sir, sa 5.76?
I don't know. I'm not sure if those budgets are there in the definitely not the Department of Water because has yet to be created. Karen, no? The bill is still being debated. But, you know, right-sizing is something governments all over the world do all the time.
Yeah.
They collapse departments and they create departments as needed because the demands of modern life require that, Karen, no? So it's something, it's not something that should be seen as unusual or earth-shaking. It's something that we must do because, you know, you must be more, government has to be responsive. It has to be efficient. It has to adjust to the requirements. And now with problems in water supply, you have to give credit to the administration for creating a ad hoc committee, which functions where all the water agencies are in order to have smoother functioning, no? But there's no one really sitting on top of that. So I think now it's the Office of the Executive Secretary that's taking the cudgels for that, no? And they're looking at how to recycle. Apparently, we're not very good at, that's what they shared with us during our initial budget hearings, is that we're not very good at using like rainfall, for instance. It could be recycled and used for many purposes.
Okay. Now, in terms of sacrificing social services, so I wanted to ask you, we lead to this. The flood control budget is at 255 billion. And yet we know that agencies like DPWH, even the DOTR, they're quite poor in spending the budget, right? You've called them out, lawmakers have called them out that we're giving you a big budget. You're not spending all of the budget. So itong 255 billion, do you think this is something, given the absorptive capacity, is this something really they could spend for the year or should some of it be transferred to social services?
But we have a, well, the first is a bit of a technical point, Karen. It refers to the cash budgeting. No, that's because we used to have a strict cash budgeting system where if you don't spend your money, if a department does not spend its budget, let's say for 2024, by December 31, 2024, the money will revert to the National Treasury.
Yeah.
But we've seen that it's the infrastructure agencies have, and among others, no, also the education agencies, because of the two-semester school year, the second semester starts in after the budget year. So they're the ones who have difficulty spending their budget within the calendar year. So we've extended that horizon for spending from 12 months to 18 months already for fiscal year 2023, as well as fiscal year 2024, to enable them to have more time to, because from experience, nahihirapan talaga to spend
so
it all.
Almost 2 years.
Contract it all. Well, it's 18 months, so a year and a half to spend the budget before it reverts para efficient. Kasi if you don't do that, if the money reverts, then you have to wait another year before you appropriate that money for the continuation or of a project, for instance. But of course, what we're also asking is that the budget be spent properly, Karen, because, you know, and you hope these are long-term solutions being planned by the department. There's talk of a 60-kilometer spillway for Central Luzon. No? So yung mga ganun, those are okay because those will last several years. So hindi lang yung yearly dredging, which is very...
I apologize for this, but the mystery goes with the dredging, right?
No, absolutely. Absolutely. I think there's that meron ganong perception because of, I mean, siguro there are really cases where it's less than optimal or it's not good spending. No? Hindi maayos yung mga project in the past. So dapat in times like this when it's really needed, maayos yung paggastos nila ng pera.
Okay, so moving now to something quite controversial is the confidential and intelligence funds. In fact, it seems to be the name of the game now with agencies when they ask for the budget. So right now, Senator, you have 28 agencies that are asking from you confidential funds, all right? Civilian yung mara, the let's, for our viewers, confidential funds can only be given to civilian agencies. Am I correct, Senator?
I have 17 agencies, Karen. I'm not sure 17. About the list of 28. Uh-oh. Yeah, the list so, given to me, 17. I have here in front of me is 17 agencies. And the good news, at least for 2024, it has not increased dramatically. No, it's around the 10 billion level. So I think on that one, and there is also a 2015 guideline that has not been discussed, which really requires stronger controls in the spending of this money. And it limits the purposes here, if I may read.
Yeah, please.
These are the allowable spending for confidential funds. A is purchase of information. B is rental of transport vehicles related to confidential activities. C is rental incidental expenses related to the maintenance of safe houses. D is purchase of rental of supplies for confidential operations that cannot be done through regular procedures without compromising the information gathering activity. E is payment of reward to informers. F is to uncover and prevent illegal activities that pose a clear and present danger to agency personnel and security under the agency protection done in coordination with the appropriate law government agencies. And G is other funds that the GAA may authorize. As a GAA, we don't really authorize additional spending naman eh. So we're just sticking to what that joint executive or joint circular by COA, DBM, the DILG, and the DND came out with in 2015. So I think the part of the objection to confidential funds is akala nila that pwedeng bulsahin yon at pwedeng gastusin sa kung ano-anong kapritsyo. But based on the circular, that's not the case, Karen. No, ito lang yung pwedeng paggastusan yung nabasa ko, yung intelligence gathering activities and then related expenses like transportation, safe houses, purchasing information, which are valid intelligence gathering activities. So the question, I guess, is which agencies should be allowed to do it? But there are no new agencies for 2024, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, no,
I think it's DICT. Sorry, I correct myself, Karen, because I'm seeing that DICT and DA are given confidential and intelligence funds for 2024. But if you look at DA, well, they have to fight things like agricultural smuggling. So I think the gathering of information related to that might be justified. Tapos sa DICT naman, you have to use intelligence to fight for cybersecurity because that's the new frontier of warfare. So I think in that case, you can justify it, the intelligence fund, Karen.
Okay. All right. So first, I'd like to credit Rappler because Rappler actually came out with a detailed list. And in their list, maybe it's a mix of both intelligence and CONFI. They named 28 agencies here. No, it's bound to get to you at some point when you deliberate on this. But I wanted to ask you, like DA, for example. So you have DA asking for 50 million. But the argument of some is, why would DA need 50 million when you have Intel funds? The Office of the President has Intel of 2.3 billion, CONFI funds of 2.25 billion. Di pa pwedeng doon na lang kunin yung 50 billion. 50
well,
million.
The fact that you already mixing funds between agencies, that tends to compromise already, I think, your intelligence, because intelligence would be limited to certain personnel only, no? So those funds of the President, I think, are for the Office of the President's operations, whereas those lodged in certain agencies are for the operations. So I would assume yung sa DA, that's for to fight things like agricultural smuggling, which has become rampant or greater in the last few years, Karen. But again, as you said, we've only begun the budget debate. So we'll ask them. I'm sure our members in the Senate, our senators will... my colleagues will ask the respective agencies how they spent, if they're receiving it for a second or more year, then or they will ask where it was spent and where they intend to spend it. But if they're receiving it for the first time, tatanungin sa kanila sa nila planong gastos inyo.
Okay. Now here's something interesting. The Office of the Vice President, the audit documents show that her CONFI funds in 2022, she actually spent 125 million only. And yet, every year, the Office of the Vice President is asking for 500 million. I mean, because these allotments can go to other agencies that need the money. So if in 2022, the OVP spent 125, why are we setting aside 500 million?
Well, that's something that usually changes. That's why you have what you call the period of amendments, Karen, no? And we're not there yet. Where we are is we're in the committee stage.
Okay.
And you can have amendments before the committee report comes out, but there's also a second period of amendments where amendments are proposed to the agency budgets. Utilization is one of the things that the Senate and the House of Representatives looks at, meaning utilization, have you been able to spend your budget? And more often than not, if you've not spent your budget fully, then it will be adjusted accordingly. In fact, the DBM also does that, no? So it's something that's done at several levels. So maybe they've not spent it because the year is not over yet, Karen.
Okay.
It's 2023. So
yeah,
they have until December 31 or even longer, actually, to spend that money. So I expect that spending will go up. You mentioned 125 million.
That's an audit report, huh?
Yes, audit report. But you have to remember, Karen, the year's not over yet. So as we speak, they're spending
2022,
that money.
Yeah. So 2022, the Commission on Audit shows that the OVP spent only 125 million of the 500 million CONFI funds.
But for 2023, I think you were speaking of the fund for 2023.
No, the report is 2022, so the proposal again for 2024 is 500. So my question would be, as a taxpayer, why are we setting aside 500 million if it's not spent every year? It's only
That's a good question. We'll see. We will.
Right?
Yeah, it's a valid question.
In other words, if you're only spending 125, it's what you need. Why are we setting aside 500 when it can go somewhere else?
Right. Well, if that's for 2022, then definitely it shows that maybe that they don't need that much money. But for 2023, where the same amount was set aside. We'll see how they've spent that when we hear the budget of the Department of the Office of the Vice President, rather.
Okay, now I want to ask you generally, you've been a senator for so long, you've been handling the budget for so long. Do you believe civilian agencies should have confidential funds, frankly speaking? Because it's grown through the years. You've seen it, Senator, the Office of the Vice President from zero to now. The Senate, you're not asking, ah. Tama ako, sir, no? Ang Senate, the Senate is not asking for CONFI funds. But with agencies through the years, you've seen it from Cory's time to Ramos's time to now, you have civilian agencies requesting for confidential funds.
Well, I guess it depends on the function of the confidential funds. Like the DOJ, Karen, is a civilian agency.
Okay.
But they have a witness protection program, for instance. They have to protect witnesses, and that has to be carried out in secrecy. So you expect that the budget of that will be like, you have to have a safe house for your witnesses. If you have to purchase information in certain cases, if you're pursuing certain cases and you cannot gather information, then that's something that I think maybe is justified, no? In the case of the DICT, they're asking for confidential funds for the first time, if I'm not mistaken, no?
Pwede naman yun.
I think that's also justified because there's national security, cyber security, the integrity of information. Because if they're also the agency charged with protecting our information, government records, no? So that should be secure. They're in pursuit of that. And you can justify it, I think, no? And maybe the DFA, in pursuit of our foreign policy, there's also a lot of national security issues. So I think in many of these... many cases, these expenses are justified. But again, it's up to each agency that they have to justify why they need it in pursuance of which program. Because it should be the exception rather than the rule, Karen. Because the rule should be transparency in the in the expenditure of public funds, taxpayer money. So and definitely the COA plays a very important role here, the Commission on Audit, kasi sila nakakakita talaga, closed audit to, pero they can really see whether the money was spent on what is laid out in the circular, what we mentioned earlier, yung purchase of information, protection of witnesses, and associated expenses dealing with the safety of government personnel.
But then with limited funding, it's also where you allot the funds. So having said, we talked about certain agencies. Here are figures that might surprise you, and I want to know your thoughts. The Philippine Coast Guard on Head Start said their intel funds is only at 10 million. The West Philippine Sea issue, but the Philippine Navy intel funds is only at 39 million. And then you have the Philippine Army for communist insurgency is at 440 million still. Considering the AFP reported, you have rebels now down at 1,800. And yet the communist insurgency intel fund of the army has not decreased. You have Coast Guard only at 10M. Malaki pa yung DepEd CONFI fund at 150 million sa Coast Guard.
But it's up to them to ask for more if they need it, Karen. No, I have to check if there's a request from the Coast Guard. That it sounds very small, as you mentioned, no, for the Coast Guard. But the thing, I'll tell you something offline later, Karen. I don't think I can, it relates to national security and the situation in the West Philippine Sea. But if there's some things you cannot really say on air.
Definitely. Okay. So, but do you believe that, just generally speaking, that there are, you know, you have 10 billion pesos of CONFI and intel funds. It increased. Do you believe, Senator, that to be fair, dapat ikut-ikuti na yon? Dapat some agencies should get more na than the others?
Yes. I think some, depending on the situation, I think you have to adjust to what the, like now there's a, increasing tensions in certain parts of the country. So definitely, you need to pay attention to these issues. No? So I think that deserves increased funding, definitely. No.
Okay.
Whatever the threats are, then you should respond accordingly with the budget.
Okay. Now, smaller scale na to, this is detailed. You may have not gotten there. Controversial last year was in education. There was no budget for SPED. Are you seeing this year that I think 500 million lang ang hinihingi ng SPED, tinanggal pa. Magkakaroon ba niyan?
I think it was just disaggregated, Karen, rather than it was specified. I think it was put in a more general program to allow flexibility, no? Hindi naman, in fairness, I don't think nawala naman siya. Kumbaga, okay. I think it was lumped in with other budgets na para pag hindi nagastos dito, pwedeng ilipat. So, but definitely hindi mawawala yung SPED budget, Karen. In fact, that's something that is one of the things that's increased, including scholarships, etc. Once it gets through the legislative or budgetary process, usually nag-increase yun, yung mga ganun. Okay.
So. Ito, another detail. I mean, these are smaller budgets compared, of course, to what you'll be reading. But UP, for example, UP is quite concerned. They're down by 3 billion, but the DBM said there have been completed projects. But UP is now saying many still require completion. They're worried that they've been slashed 3 billion.
Again, I'm not worried, Karen, because you're comparing apples and oranges because you're looking at the completed budget of 2023 and comparing it with the initial budget of 2024.
Okay.
So if you compare initial, I'm confident that the UP budget will increase because historically it has increased after passing through both houses of Congress. So that 3 billion comparison or negative balance will be rectified and increased by the time December comes around and we've been through the budgetary process. Kasi maraming re-request. Yung UP, lalapit yan sa mga UP graduates like myself, like Senator Pia, Senator Cheese, Senate President Miggs, to fund, who've been funding and inserting projects like Senate President has been really funding a lot of the projects of UP Los Baños, for instance. Senator P and I have been funding the PGH, for instance, a lot of the budgetary insertions for PGH. So I'm not too worried because ganyan talaga, the DBM, when it proposes its budget, it doesn't look at the finished figure. If it's a congressional insertion, they'll remove that in the initial submission to Congress because they expect Congress to insert again for the next year.
Okay, so before we go to a quick break, because we'll talk about the MUP after, two questions for you regarding the budget. As a senator, what is your personal, this is personal. Of course, you are chairperson of the Senate Finance Committee, but I'm sure you have a personal advocacy when it comes to the budget. Ano yung personal mong binabantayan? Pondohan, tumataas ang pondo. Although objectivity is of course expected of you, there must be a pet something there. What is it?
It's something actually that I have a separate bill on. But even this early, hindi pa pasado yung bill. It's a Tatak Pinoy advocacy, yeah. Karen, where we're trying to help local industries and producers through the budget, no? Although you cannot outrightly subsidize sectors that would go against world or international trade rules, you can do things which support them and make them more competitive. No? Like you can sponsor roadshows for our small and medium enterprises. The government can spend for participation in book fairs or art fairs or music festivals or film festivals. So these are the things where I think the government can level up, can help Filipino talents, Filipino producers. It's a bill I have, the Tatak Pinoy bill, which has the president has included among his priority measures, and we thank him for that. He mentioned it in his last SONA. We've had the committee hearings for manufacturing, for agriculture, for culture and heritage, for tourism. So we're trying to identify some of the stumbling blocks and some of the agencies which can help. And I think the DTI, in fairness to the Department of Trade, it does a good job of helping some of our, with a limited budget, no? It does a good job of helping our entrepreneurs with what it has. And it's looking, it carves out roadmaps for different industries. And the goal is really to have more sophisticated products, because the finding of the literature is that it's the countries who have the highest per capita incomes are those who have the greatest array of diversified and sophisticated products, meaning what others would call value-added products, Karen. No? Mm-hmm. So it's rather than exporting just fish or coconut, you'll export more sophisticated products in their processed state. Like it could be processed fish or coconut in its many forms, like VCO, virgin coconut oil. That's an example of a value-added product, no? So, mm-hmm. So tayo, we produce, it's time maybe to get into more higher-end manufacturing, as long as there are industries who are up to the task, and see how government can support them. Because we're manufacturing the parts of airplanes, for instance, the parts of cell phones in some of our technoparks in the Southern Tagalog region, in Cebu. We have great furniture makers. We even make boats. So it's time to look at how government. Why doesn't government? Sometimes it's government. Yung government pa yung hindi bumibili nung gawa sa atin. So it's time to make it a priority. Na if all things being equal, as long as the government is not getting a bad deal, there's a price. There's a provision in the government procurement law that as long as the variance does not exceed 15%, then Philippine products should be chosen or considered. So I think that's something that we should look at implementing very well. As long as the government is not getting a bad deal, the products meet the specifications, then by all means, let's make sure we prioritize our own.
Okay, two quick ones, just very quickly, because we need to go to a break. But I wanted to ask you, the West Philippine Sea issue, you have Senator Cheese Escudero suggesting set aside 100 million, build a structure in Ayungin, you know, to solidify it. Some have said that it might be too confrontational. I mean, what are your thoughts when it comes to the Ayungin controversy?
Well, I think it's a great idea, but execution is the problem, because just the bringing of supplies already creates some kind of conflict. But we should maybe exhaust all means, you know, diplomatic and otherwise, so that we can exert our sovereign rights over these areas. No.
Mm-mm. Okay. Last, this is your fifth budget, correct?
I think so. Yeah, I think that's right.
Yeah, this is your fifth budget. That's what I've read. And this will be your last budget, because this is your last term. You're going to take a break. So what is the biggest challenge always when you go through the budget? What are you looking out for this one?
Well, the prioritization is always the hardest, Karen, because there's so many needs, and budgeting involves prioritization. It's always difficult to prioritize between all these needs. But I think one thing I learned from my father and those who I admire is that you never sacrifice really the spending on education and health, because that's something that that goes a long way. You know, every peso spent for education, for health, I think is important, no? So that's but the challenge is always prioritization between the different needs. I mean, you have needs for defense, you have needs for infrastructure, you have needs for social spending and ayuda. So how you divide the pie up between all of these is the difficulty. But it's not something I do alone, Karen. Don't forget, no. I think I have a dozen vice chairpersons in the Senate who make some of these decisions. We make these decisions collectively.
Just two more issues, a few seconds to go. The Maharlika Investment Fund. I spoke with Secretary Ben Diokno on Head Start. He believes it can earn something like 8% when the fund is invested to infra. Is this where you envision the fund to go? Because yung people may DPWH naman na budget, may PPP pa. Bakit pa tayo nag-fund kung dun rin pupunta?
Well, the fund is really to make money, no? So maybe from Sec Ben's standpoint, he's the finance secretary and he sees which projects make money. Maybe he's thinking of toll roads, because those definitely will make money. It's potentially, maybe it could, you know, I really don't know. You have to ask someone who's better at investments. That's not really my area of expertise, Karen. No.
But
I'd like to say
vision?
Is that, sorry.
Did you have a vision? Because I remember speaking with some businessmen before that it could have been, let's say, for green businesses, right? The let's say pushing the green economy, something.
Well, it's really for to make money, because if you look at the sovereign fund of Singapore, for instance, Temasek and GIC, they're really to make money. They invest in Globe and they look at the bottom line of companies, Karen. So it's really a business decision. But Maharlika is a bit hybrid, I think, because it can be a business decision, but it can also be to meet sovereign needs. So that's something that we have to decide which way we're going.
Okay. My last question is your thoughts on the military and uniformed personnel pension reform. You have the Defense Secretary, Gibo Teodoro, already questioning the indexation, the mandatory contribution that's being discussed in the House panel. I'm sure, Senator, you've seen the divisions, 3%, 5%, 9%, 3% increase a year. Just overall, what are your thoughts?
Well, we're actually waiting for an actuarial study of the GSIS. We were told by the economic managers that it's coming out very soon. So we want to look at that. That will see the projections of how long the life of a pension fund is. But as you know, the MUP is very unique in the sense because it's funded by the national budget. Wala siyang contributions. So it's unique in that sense. So I think the most difficult decisions here include at what point do you ask military personnel to contribute? Because I understand there is a bill asking those who have served 20 years. That's difficult. Mm-hmm. That's a tough one because they've given their service and then it was not part of their entering the service. No? So, madali yung papasok pa lang. You can say, ikaw, you have to contribute. Ha? Kasi, pero yun, papasok pa lang yun. Eh. Pero yung nagbigay servisyo na, suddenly, kakaltasan mo ng ganong... That's a bit more difficult, di ba?
Yeah.
And it's also unique in the sense that the pension increases as the salary increases. Mm-hmm. Our pensions... They're tied to what our salary was.
Yes.
So that's the unique thing about the military. No, it's always one position higher. And if the salary goes up of the one occupying that position, if you retired as a chief of staff, for instance, you will be getting what the present chief of staff gets. That's what makes it unique. No, whereas Sunny Angara will get what Sunny Angara's salary was. So his pension will be based on what Sunny Angara's salary was. So yun ang unique dun. So the question is, do we still maintain that kind of system?
Yeah.
Well, we'll have to look at the numbers to see, no? But of course, there's a question of fairness
also. Offhand, do you feel it's sustainable? Because you do have Sec Jokno saying this is not sustainable.
And clearly, it's already very difficult to sustain because now the pensions are even bigger than the salaries. Nagbabalun siya, Karen. That's the thing because... there are no contributions to source the pensions from. That's the difficulty here. So at some point, you really have to make it contributory. So yung madali nga dyan, as I said earlier, is you will ask the new entrants to contribute. But at what point do you ask those in the service already? Because they've given their blood, they've shed, some have given their lives actually, no? So... It's very sensitive and we have to be very sensitive to it's yung pagkukonsulta is very important here. And the military, I think, has told us that they don't want to feel like they're being singled out. So it should be a holistic reform of the pension system.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much for joining me today, sir. Senator Sunny Angara, chairperson of the Senate Finance Committee. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. It's always something we look forward to, Karen. Thank you very much.